Our last set of discussions here on vector data in this list, in this module, going back to the beginning of vector data formats. Going back to those Roger Tomlinson days. And the development beyond the early GIS really required a reckoning with the idea of digitizing information into kind of a self-referential grid versus making it so that those digitized pieces of information were universally relatable and could be related not only to themselves, but to other pieces of data in the database, and then to other pieces of data not in the database. Making sure that those relationships between features were explicit became part of this early standardization work in GIS. So there's the digitizing board. It's a little bit more advanced than the one Roger Tomlinson had and all of his buddies, but that's okay. These don't really exist anymore. Maybe as some display pieces somewhere, but we can do all of our digitizing on the computer now. Speaking of computers, look at that antique. A big old CRT monitor, gorgeous. And there's our vector structure again too, right? That looks very familiar. This is a much older example, but it looks very familiar to how we think about vector today. In fact, it's just about the same. A point is a point. Now we can see the underlying grid system here, the underlying coordinates. In this coordinate system, it's basically just a graph, right? We have an x-axis and a y-axis, and our point is at 13, 1. And our line starts at 2, 2, and then goes to 8, 2, and then goes to 12, 7. Those points become the nodes in the vertices. That's the way. And we see this term called chain. I guess that makes sense from a perspective. A chain links the two different nodes. Life is good and carries on. Then our polygon, right? The same thing. It's node one to vertex one to two to three to four back to node one. A polygon is just a bunch of lines, and lines are just connections of points. Topology then comes up because we need explicit information and details that describe the spatial relationships of features. We need to know when they're next to each other or connected to each other or above or below or west or east. All of those words that we've learned in primary school or wherever you learn them about how data works. Not even how data works, how things work. The dog is on the house. Dog's on the house. Where's the dog? It's on the house. Spatial relationship words. To actualize that computationally is difficult. And this is very similar to topology in mathematics. I outran those mathematicians, by the way. Because the topology that we might understand in understanding the relationship, the topological functions of shapes and features and mathematical relationships works the same way inside of GIS. Topology establishes those relationships and allows us to understand if our data is without errors. Are our polygons complete? Do the lines match up? Because if we have inaccurate data, we have inaccurate spatial analysis, and that makes us sad. As Roger Tomlinson was building up his GIS, and as others were working as well, eventually figuring out how to track links, how to compare your work to someone else in a different department, how to organize and store all these relationships became difficult. We had to figure out how to keep track of links between features. This eventually led us to the ARC node model. where we have arcs, which are relationships between different points. Those points are nodes. And then polygons are simply agglomerations of arcs. So in this case, we can see we have all of our points in our points file, 1 to 13. You can see them all on the map there. Arc 1, or line 1, runs between points 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Arc 2 runs between 1, 8, 9, so on and so on. And then our polygon is composed of arcs 1 and 2. This then gives us a structured topology, which we can reference back, because our polygon is made up of lines and our line is made up of points. And our point is made up of coordinates, but gotta have two of them to understand anything. This is embedded in everything you do within vector data in GIS. And it's really important to think of conceptually, because there will come a time when you have a polygon that is incomplete. There is a time when your line data will have an inaccurate network. And then we have to think about, okay, what is broken and how do we fix it? So ArcNode came together after what must have been a great party, the first international advanced symposium on topological data structures for geographic information systems. Ooh, 1979, you know that was a rager. ArcS became the fundamental data storage unit, and polygons were built for them. We can see that in another set of examples here using realer XY information. In this case, we have nodes which are representing latitudes and longitudes. Hey, those probably sound familiar from middle school earth science or something. These are the locations we use to navigate on the planet. Now we're in a real world coordinate system, and not just in theoretical XY land. We have our nodes 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Wait a second, that kind of looks like our feature ID we saw in the attribute table earlier. Eventually, as we start to standardize and build out these relationships, we shift our terminology or we shift our functionality of these. But it comes down to, we have a certain individual uniquely identifiable point, and it connects to a location. And then we have arcs that are built from there. And we have polygons that are built from those arcs. Now, over time, we became more adept at defining arcs that weren't just linear pieces that could have shape and structure to them. We could design and build systems that allowed us a little bit more freedom in that creation. Which gives us then the contiguity of our shapes and functions. Keep these topological considerations in mind as you work forward to Lab 3.